building a young adult community within our church, and now we're ready to take it online. And this is what I want to invite you to, an online space in which young adults, young people, young families, young couples can come and get together and just experience God, help one another navigate just the difficulties of life and help each other to understand how it is that we bring Christ into all of those things. I think it's very difficult to adult on your own, and I think a lot of the times we don't share really what's going on with us and what we're going through. But if we really spoke about it like we aim to do within this community, you see that a lot of people are going through the same things. So please come and join us. Bring your friends, bring those who just want to know a bit more about God, and if you just want to go a bit deeper and meet some interesting people, please join us. We'll be online, the young adult community.
How's it, guys? Thank you for the opportunity to just quickly have a chat with you. AJ, Jocelyn, I would quickly like to tell you a story about how we met and how God has been in our lives. And funny story, we met on an online platform called Tinder. I'm sure a lot of you are known with that platform. We've now been married 3.5 years. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and loving every moment of it.
Yeah, absolutely. We, just before we met online, we had kind of seeked God in our own time. So a year before we met, we actually both got saved, a couple months apart. So it was just amazing for us to see how God readied our heart for marriage and for what he had to come. It was a quick process. We met and got engaged and got married quickly, because I think when you know, when God is saying go, he releases you. And it's been a great journey. We have 3 children. One of them I brought into the marriage, and he's just been fabulous with her. And then we have 2 little boys.
Yeah, AJ Jr., the third, and David Bradley. So 2 beautiful boys, which we are raising as Christian men and Christian ladies in God. Yeah, guys, I think something that's on my heart today and something that I would like to chat to you guys about is you know, a career. I think, you know, in our times, we've gone through various ups and downs, and I mean, that's life. You know, you'll get your good moments and your bad moments. And where we are sitting now in a situation called lockdown, you know, there's so many blessings that God has bestowed upon us, depending on how you look at it. I mean, if you start every day with a positive attitude, you are definitely going to go into that day with a special attitude. And I'm sorry, I'm stealing a bit of time here, but you know, God is important in every situation in your life, and it's important that that is your foundation, no matter what season you're in. And you know, for me personally, what I've learned over the last 3 years with this woman next to me is that A, you need to find your self-worth in God, no matter what. If you are looking at your spouse to make you happy, it's going to be a tough time for yourself. God needs to be that anchor in your life. And no matter what, there's nothing as important as God and as your family at the end of the day. And cherish every moment that you guys have with each other, whether you're in a relationship, whether you're married. It's important to absolutely give your heart 100% to the person next to you.
We want to start with a theme over the next couple of weeks covering the topic of relevance. What is the relevance of the Bible, Jesus, the history of Israel, and how does it apply to us today? Is it even appropriate? Is it contextual? What am I supposed to do with it as a person who is living today? So I want to hone in on Jesus, and why did I feel like it was applicable for this community specifically? Because we need to answer the question of what does it mean to have Jesus as my Lord and Savior? What does it mean for me today? What does it mean for me as a person who is considering Jesus? Why would I need to consider Jesus today, right now, as I live my life? For me personally, I grew up in a home where my parents were pastors. I grew up in church. I grew up knowing nothing else but the Christian story. In 2007, my dad, who was a pastor, decided that Christianity doesn't work for him, and he started questioning the very origin, the roots, everything that had to do with the Christian narrative. And you can imagine what that does for you who's known this to be your story your whole life. So I had to go on a personal journey of being confronted with what I have known to be the truth and interrogated for its accuracy, for its relevance, the journey that I'm inviting you to go on with me now. So this is personal to me, but I also know that a lot of people are in this space, in this season, during this time, reflecting on everything, because the pandemic, COVID, is giving us more time to reconsider everything about how we do our lives. And so I know that our faith is not excused, is not exempt from this analysis. And so here we are. Let's go on this journey together. We want to start in the book of Colossians, Colossians 1, 15 to 20. So I'm going to read it. It's talking about the preeminence of Christ. I really love the scripture. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He's the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, and in everything he might have preeminence. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile himself to all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of the cross. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the authority that the scriptures carry. Father, I thank you that this is the living breath of God, and that as I read it, Lord God, breath is coming into me, but not only that, it is extending to every person listening. Father, I pray for the seeker, for the questioner, for even the one who is interrogating their faith, Lord God, that in this moment you would meet with us and invite us on the journey, Lord God, of coming with you, Lord God, as you teach us about who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. So that is our scripture. That is the basis on which where we start our journey. I want to look at Jesus, his life, his gospel, his death, his resurrection. So we start with the life of Jesus. I find it interesting when we look at scripture and we note that God came into Palestine as a baby. Not only that, a baby born into a scandal. Not only that, a scandal, and then he was on the run. You know, because his parents were fleeing from a king who was wanting to have him executed. This is how God chooses to enter into the human story. This is how God chooses to start his life on earth. Through a scandal, through rejection, God chooses the most inconvenient circumstances for the entrance of a king. And if you think about what you think about, if you think of God, when you think of deity, when you think of majesty, I don't think that that's the picture that comes to mind. So we have to ask ourselves that why did God intentionally choose that these would be the circumstances of his birth? Not only that, the life that Jesus lived. He was born in a manger. He was born in a, you know, with animals around him. Hey, can you just imagine that picture? And they say that this is the king. This is the Messiah, the promised one whom everybody was waiting for. And yet this is the circumstance that he chooses to enter into the kingdom, enter into life with. You know, he arranged the most humiliating circumstances in that day. I mean, even today, having a child out of wedlock is frowned upon. But imagine back then, more conservative, more times when that kind of thing, people would be stoned for it. That is our king, and that's where he came from. Why do you think that he chose those kinds of circumstances? Why do you think he chose that kind of journey, that kind of history to be associated with God? Jesus' suffering didn't start on the cross. A lot of the times when we talk about Jesus and how he suffered, we are referring to the cross, and indeed he did suffer. However, Jesus' suffering didn't start on the cross. So picture this. A God came and restricted and restrained himself to be a man. So all the fullness of deity, Colossians 1 says, the fullness of God was pleased to dwell in him as a person. So that is all of God's power, all of God's authority, all of God's unlimitedness restrained to a human limit. So not only that, as a baby who needs his diaper changed, as a baby whose life depends on these teenagers who are on the run and how they choose to obey and follow the leading of the Spirit. This is how God chose to enter into the earth. And so in that, he chose to restrain his deity to the limit of what it is to be human. Absolute torture, absolute suffering. And so every moment that Jesus lived on the earth, every single moment, it was him suffering. It was him walking in human limitation, restricting himself to everything that we would go through as human beings, so that when he says, we do not have a high priest who cannot identify with our weakness, it means way more than what we think it means when we just observe the scriptures. Further on, we look at how Jesus lived. He didn't live with opulence. He didn't live with a lot of money. I mean, Jesus needed to borrow money for him to make his point. He was telling that parable and trying to make an example of Caesar, like whether we should give to Caesar or whether we should, you know, what is the right thing to do? He said, can I use your coin? Why doesn't he have his own coins? The second time when you see Jesus interacting with just finances and money, he pulls out a coin from, you know, from the mouth of a whale. It's like, there is this relationship that Jesus had with material, like finances, resources, commerce. And we look at that and we realize that he wasn't wealthy. He didn't choose to live in a castle. He didn't choose to come as the kings of the day came. He didn't choose to live that way. These are the circumstances that just giving you a picture of the life that Jesus lived. So from that, if you could just reflect on what does that mean when we say we are living like God, we are wanting to be like God, that we are people of God. We talk about Jesus' gospel. So when we talk about the gospel and we talk about salvation and the message of salvation, we talk about the cross, we talk about the fact that Jesus saves and that he came to die for us. But the gospel is so much more than that. And what is the gospel that Jesus preached? In Mark 1, 14 to 15, it reads like this. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. So what is the gospel that Jesus proclaimed? The kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus came to announce his kingdom. Jesus came to announce that the king is here. So when he said the time is fulfilled, he was saying, the king is here. I'm here. I'm here to lead. I'm here to rule. I'm here to begin and end that which was there from the beginning, that which was intended from the beginning. He's here to introduce the rule of God. Now, the kingdom of God is not a place. Yes, its origin is in heaven, but its destination is here on earth. Where do we see this? In Matthew 6, verse 10, when Jesus is praying, he says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So its origins are in heaven, but its destination is right here on earth. What does that mean? It means that the sphere of God's rule, it means that the elements that represent who God's is, God's authority is now here on earth. And this is what Jesus came to announce and to proclaim, to say there is a new era, there is a new dawn, there is a new king, and he's now here on earth. He's always been king, but he's now here physically dwelling with you on earth. And this was not just a proclamation, but it was also an invitation. Now, to the Jews of the day, this was not a surprise. So to hear that the king is here, the Messiah has come, that wasn't a surprising thing because they were waiting for the Messiah. They were waiting for a king. They were waiting for an overturn of everything that was going wrong, a person, a God who was going to come and make things right. Long awaited. The issue was that this king died. And not only did he die, then there was a story about resurrection that people didn't understand. So here's what the Jews were waiting for. They were waiting for the end of the suffering on earth, the end of the rule of this kingdom and the beginning of another kingdom, right? So they were waiting for almost earth to end and heaven to begin. But here Jesus comes in and there's almost like this transition where he says, I'm here, the kingdom is here, it's coming and it's being ushered in through me. But then at the same time, it seems as if there's a handover where he says, now you continue living as people, as inheritance, as ambassadors of the kingdom here on earth. And so that was not what the Jews were expecting. And that's why for many of them, there's still that rejection of that couldn't have been the Messiah. The Messiah who died, that doesn't make any sense. So what did the kingdom mean? It means that God was here to lead. He was not just here to lead. He was here to invite us to lead with him. Not only that, it's like there are ways in which the kingdom was already, and then there's ways in which the kingdom is not yet. That is a popular phrase that you'll hear. And so what does that mean? What does it mean that the kingdom is already here? Well, what we see is Jesus started healing people physically. Jesus told people that they were forgiven of their sins. So what happened at the cross is that what the Jews were expecting to happen at the end, which is the judgment of all evil, here it is happening in the middle of time. So God is judging evil. God is forgiving sins, but it's not happening at the end on that judgment day that everybody's expecting. It happened here in the middle of time. And so now it's like, okay, now your sins are forgiven. What happens next? Because for most people, there was this understanding of, you know, heaven or death or judgment day is this line that you cross. And once you've made it to the other side, you're free, right? So when you believe that, then salvation is this line that you cross so that you've made it. And you are among those who are counted as those who belong and not those who are going to hell. But Jesus was introducing something very interesting. He was saying, not only do you cross the line, right? There is something expected of us on the other side. I have called you to live in my kingdom, to participate in the way that it works. And there is an expectation of us to do what Jesus did. So he has a real realistic expectation that we would do exactly what he did. He says, greater things than me will you do. So it means that God's plan to bring the kingdom to earth started with Jesus, and then Jesus handed it over to us. So we get to participate in his mission of bringing the kingdom here on earth. So it's not just about crossing over the line, those who've made it, those who haven't. No, that is the beginning of the story, but we get invited on a journey with God. Resurrection. Not only did Jesus die, he was raised to life. So on the one hand, that would have meant that that's it. Jesus is done. He did it. We can all go home. But he resurrected. And when he did that, he began a process in which all of us are going to be resurrected. The whole of earth is going to be resurrected. That's what the Jews were waiting for. But it didn't happen in the way that they wanted. And some of us are feeling like, okay, so Jesus came, he said it was finished, and then he left. What does that mean? What does that mean for me today? Well, it means that in one way, the kingdom is already here. We pray for the sick and we have a real expectation that they will be healed because this is what we saw Jesus do. And not only that, his disciples started to do it. So that kills the notion of, no, but Jesus could only do it because he was God. His disciples weren't, and they did what they saw the king doing. So how do our lives emulate that? How do we participate in the fullness of the kingdom that is already? That is, we get to usher in all of who God is in the spheres where we exist. And in another way, the kingdom is not yet in its fullness. It's not yet in its complete form. And we see that because there's still suffering. There's still poverty. There is still that declaration that we're waiting for the fulfillment of in Isaiah 61, where the Father says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to reveal freedom for the captives and release from darkness the prisoners. We still have people in prison. We still have people in poverty. The world is not yet made right. So until we bring about the fullness of the rightness of the world, we're not done. And if we're not done, it means the kingdom is not yet complete. It's not yet experiencing the fullness of what God would have had us bring here on earth. So we have work to do. But that's not the full story. God has already done the work. He's done the work in our hearts. He's done the work in our lives. He's given us the mandate. And he's gone all the way to the end and declared it as successful and done. So we are not working towards a salvation. We are saved. We know who God is. And if we are not yet, there is an opportunity for us to get saved. There is an opportunity for us to join, participate, and become a member of the household of God. This invitation is for everyone, by grace, through faith, not by anyone's work. But for those of us who have crossed over the line, that is the beginning of a journey. So let's walk with perseverance the race that has been marked for us. But not only that, let's read the scripture and understand who the person of Jesus is and what does it mean to participate in the story of resurrection through God. The king came to earth as a man. His name is Jesus. And he came so that we could relate. He came so that he could fulfill the story of God. He came so that we could participate in his story. God is on mission. We are part of God's mission. God is inviting you to participate in his mission. If you're sitting there and you have never responded to the Lord, or you've never taken interest to know who Jesus introduced himself as, how Jesus is introducing himself to you, we'd like to welcome you to join the household of God. All of us here, we are on a journey. We're trying to figure it out. We're trying to learn what God expects of us. But not only that, who God is to us. He's a father. He's a king. He's our father. He's your father. So if you're there, you've been asking questions, or you've seen yourself as somebody who's excluded from the community of God, I'd like to tell you that God is inviting you to come closer. Come to where he is. He is coming after you. He is after your heart and he loves you. And if you're there and you've been doubting and you've got questions, this is also the place for you. This is the place where you're allowed to come and reason together. You can come into the house of the Lord and seek so that you can find. And this is what we are all doing together. And it's not going to happen all in one day, but we are committed to the journey with you. So can I pray for you? Father, thank you for this time, Lord God. Thank you for everybody here, Lord God, listening, Lord God, people who are coming on a journey with you, whether they're aware of it or not. Father, thank you that your invitation started before the beginning of time, and that even now you keep beckoning, calling out for your children to come back home. Father, I thank you for every person listening, even, Lord God, those with questions. And Father, I thank you that there is a deposit that you've planted in each person's heart, and that right now, Lord God, that deposit, Lord God, you're going to see it to fruition, Lord God. You're going to complete the story that you've started in people. And for that heart, Lord God, that is responding to you right now, Father, I thank you, Lord God, that there is an opportunity all the time to say yes to you. And so, Father, we just welcome, Lord God, every heart that is agreeing to come into your household, Lord God, into the family right now, in Jesus' name. Amen. If that's you, and you are ready to start a journey with Jesus, even with your questions, but you're ready to submit your life, to give your life to the Lord, we'd like to welcome you to come into our believing family, to come into the household of God. And you can do that by clicking on the link that is going to appear in the comment section. We do that because we value connection, we value you, and we value family. And so we invite you to become a part of our family, God's family. Next up, going to hand over to AJ.
Joining us again today for our community broadcast. Right after this, please join us for a quick session on prayer. And if there's any specific request that you would like, guys, just please click on the link, follow us on the Zoom call, and let's make mountains move. Thank you so much.
So Jesus. We pour out our hearts to you, Jesus.
Cause your love has won us.
Pour out our hearts to you, Jesus.
Cause your love has freed us.
We pour out our hearts to you, Lord.
Cause your love has freed us.
So we pour out our lives to you, Jesus.
Jesus, your love has freed us.
Freed us, Jesus, your love has freed us.
Jesus, your love has freed us.
Jesus, your love has freed us.
Jesus, your love
has freed us. Your love has freed us. Your love has freed us. Jesus, your love has freed us. Cause you are worthy, 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 Lord.